Shout out to my advisory. Well, good morning. It is an absolute pleasure and an honor to be with you this morning. Today, we are going to talk about miracles, and this is kind of a fun thing to dig into. We're going to look at it both from a biblical perspective, a little bit of philosophy, a little bit of science, and we're going to hear some incredible stories today, I hope, as well. The first story is this, and this is why I think why this topic resonates with me so much. My oldest son is kind of a miracle that he's still here, and I actually hijacked him from class over at the middle school today. Come on up, Neil. Come on, sorry. Right, here he is. Yeah. Everybody, this is my son, Nathan, John Gregory the First. Go ahead and wave. Say hello. Freshmen, sophomores, juniors, seniors. There we go. Right? When he was really little, 3 years old, he had an ear infection, and you know, lots of people have ear infections. You get antibiotics, you go home, you're better. And unfortunately, this one didn't go away. And one day, it was actually on a Mother's Day, his entire face just popped out. So this handsome face right here was like off of round. It looked kind of like this. And he came in from playing, and thank you. And you can stay. And he came in from playing outside, and I said, dude, what happened to your face? And I said, was it a spider bite or something? Yeah, that's a bad question, right? And I said, was it a spider bite or something? And he goes, you know, he's three, so he goes, sure, yeah, a spider bite. And actually what ended up happening was this ear infection had eaten through a bone in his ear and just kind of lodged on his brain. And then the pus filled the side of his face, and he went from being perfectly healthy to needing to be in a helicopter and being transported, and unfortunately it was too foggy, so they took him in an ambulance. And then we were told he could have a stroke at any minute, lots of bad things could have happened, and it would take months of IV antibiotics and some really strong stuff to kill this germ that was causing all these problems. And 10 days in Children's Hospital later, his infectious disease doctor came up and said, she found us playing out in the gardens at Children's Hospital, which is where we spent most of our time, right? It was kind of fun. And she goes, Gregory's, I knew I'd find you here. And I said, what's up? She says, it's gone. I said, what do you mean it's gone? We did another MRI, it's gone. I said, that's impossible. She says, I know. She says, medically I have no way of explaining it. And I said, well, you know, I did go in after I had some very, very harsh words with God initially. I went in and I placed my hands on his head and I prayed that the Holy Spirit would intervene. And if we don't have a medical intervention that explains things, could it be? And she goes, oh, no, I mean, you know, I guess anything's possible. But the important thing is you're going home tomorrow, right? So my son, whether you believe it or not, I really do believe that God worked a miracle in his life. And he is living proof that God does things like that. And that's it. Your life as a prop is now over. You get to go sit down now. Hug your dad, though. Love you. Thank you. Give him a round of come on. He's like, thank you. He's a sixth grader. Thank you. So when we talk about miracles, what are we looking at? Well, this is a book that many of us on staff have been reading, and it's a New York Times bestseller. And in it, the first half kind of talks about what miracles are, and then the second half of the book is stories, and that's kind of what we're going to do today, too. A miracle, this is just from the dictionary, an extraordinary event manifesting divine intervention in human affairs, or an extremely outstanding or unusual event, thing, or accomplishment. We're going to focus on the first thing. Most people, when they think miracle, they don't just think, wow, that was lucky. They think, did God do something? And I think God did something, and God does things more than we'd like to realize sometimes. So the first thing that I want to talk about, even if you're going to hear a story in a minute from someone who had an even more exceptional miracle happen to them, the only time I've heard of this happening face-to-face, actually, you're going to hear somebody's story of that in just a few minutes. But before we get to that, you might hear that story, and at the end, really, I'm speaking to any of you in here who are skeptical of God. Of the existence of God, of whether God can be active in your life. I want for you today to ask yourself this question. If I could show you today that it was more reasonable than not that God actually did intervene at least once in human affairs, would you then believe in God? And I think many of you who don't believe would say, well, yeah, I would. But in truth, I think your answer is probably not. If you use there's no proof for God as an excuse not to believe in God or as a reason not to believe in God, I think there's actually something deeper going on underneath. And so at the end of the chapel, we'll kind of get into that a little bit more. But the first miracle that I want to kind of look at is the miracle of creation. Have you ever asked yourself the question, why is there something rather than nothing? Right? If you've studied science, you know that physical matter does not create itself. When I see this water bottle here, and somebody might say, oh, who put the water bottle there? If I said, it just appeared there, you would say, no, that's wrong, because water bottles don't just make themselves appear. That can't really happen, right? So the existence of anything is kind of a miracle, but the existence of this universe itself is a real miracle. Cambridge University mathematician John Lennox said that for anything in this universe to form, we're talking stars, planets, all the rest of that, some of the major laws, the cosmological constants they're called, are so finely tuned that if you took a coin, and then you took that coin 20 billion light years away to the edge of the observable universe, and then you drew a bow and an arrow, and you shot, if you hit that coin, those are the kinds of odds we're talking about, that there would be anything at all in existence today. So if you don't buy the story about my son or the story you're about to hear, you still need to consider the fact that you sitting here is a miracle. There is no great scientific explanation for it. Here's another way of looking at it. There's a dime, right? Now, if you took a dime and you covered all of North America with it, this a brilliant scientist, Hugh Ross, came up with this, and it was in Metaxas' book that I just put up there. He did these calculations. If you took a dime and you covered North America with it, and then you kept layering dimes up, and then you had, if you had five layers of dimes covering North America, and then you stacked those up a billion times, you'd get all the way to the moon and probably beyond. If you then took one of those dimes and colored it red and inserted it back into those pile of dimes all the way up to the moon, as big as the country, then blindfolded a friend and said, go find that dime. If he found it, there are greater odds of that happening than our universe being here without a designer. So the first miracle is that you're sitting here. And even before that is that there's a here to sit in, right? And so when we think about miracles and we ask for, like, we talk about divine intervention and things like that, the first thing that we have to say is if you are sitting here and thinking, you are a miracle, and existence itself is a miracle. But when, you know, when we think about that, that's really not what we want to talk about when we talk about miracles. We kind of want examples, right? And we're not alone with this. In Matthew 16, the Pharisees demanded more miracles from Jesus as proof that he was who he said he was. In Matthew 16, it says, the Pharisees and Sadducees came to Jesus and tested him by asking him to show them a sign from heaven. He replied, when evening comes, you say it will be fair weather, for the sky is red. Doesn't take a genius to figure that out. And even less geniusness is used. Geniusness is not a word. Genius, I don't know. And in the morning, today it will be stormy, for the sky is red and overcast. You see clouds and you say it's going to be stormy. You don't have to be a genius to figure that out either. You know how to interpret the appearance of the sky, but you cannot interpret the signs of the times. Why did he say this? He had just fed 4,000 people. And then the Pharisees come and they say, oh, we need another miracle. And if Jesus wasn't really careful, he could have just been every person's personal miracle worker, which is exactly what Satan asked him to be in the wilderness, and exactly at the end of his life, what Herod asked him to do in his palace. And Jesus was not here to come up to you and say, what miracle can I do for you to convince you today? He was instead teaching us that one day God would bring his kingdom fully to earth and all of life would resemble a miracle. So people have been asking for examples and for miracles since before the time of Jesus. And there's a lot of kind of, there's a lot of iffy theology about miracles too. Like, some people say the miracle is dependent on the faith of the person. So, and one of the things I want you to take home from this is, if you've been, we've all prayed for a miracle, and all of us have not received a miracle that we prayed for. And I want you to hear loud and clear that the message of Jesus is that you are not the arbiter of who receives miracles and who doesn't. It is not your faith that is the deciding factor in miracles. Sometimes, in the New Testament, God uses faith to heal people. And sometimes he uses mud. And sometimes he uses spit. And sometimes he prays from afar. And other times, he gets to a place and he cries, and then he brings his friend out through some other kind of miracle, regardless of that person's faith. The person who was brought to the house and descended through the roof in the Gospel of Mark, he didn't have faith in Jesus necessarily. It was his friends who lowered him through, who had faith that Jesus could heal him. The guy was paralyzed. He couldn't do much. But there's a lot of theology about miracles that kind of take the focus off of God and they put it on us. So I'm going to ask Liz and Dalton to come up and sing a song that you will all probably recognize. And afterwards, we're going to chat just for a couple of seconds about the theology that is present in this song about miracles.
So hopeful, some we barely understood. Now we are not afraid, although we know there's much to fear. He was moving mountains long before we knew he could. There can be
time I watch the Prince of Egypt and that song starts singing, a little tear comes. I mean, it's just dust in the room, but a little tear comes to my eye, I'm sure. And I love that song, right? But Liz actually changed the words. It says, who knows what miracles we can achieve. She changed it to, he can achieve. Or actually, it was, he was moving mountains. In the real song, it says, we were moving mountains. And so often, we want to do with miracles what we like to do with everything else, and that is make it about us. And the reality is that miracles were given to us, and the stories in the Bible were given to us about miracles because, one, I think they actually happened, and two, they are signs to point us to God. They are not things for us to realize we have brilliance inside of us, and if we just let it out, then the world will be conquered by our brilliance and our miracles. Right? The reality is, it is God who freed the people from Egypt. And it is God who made the Exodus happen. And it is God who came and descended to earth and lived as one of us. And it is God who died for our sins. And it is God who resurrected. Well, speaking of resurrection, on Easter Sunday, last Easter Sunday, I was preaching. And I kind of gave what I thought was a throwaway line in my sermon. And that was, I just said, I don't know about you, but I've never met anyone who rose from the dead. And then I went on to give my sermon. And then... After service, I was going around and meeting some people, and there were some new folks there because we did a baby dedication that day. And I walked up to a young woman who I now know was Jessie, and I said, oh, hi, nice to meet you. She said, you have now? I said, what? And she goes, you've met someone who's risen from the dead now. And I was like, who? She goes, me. And I was like, there was a line of people waiting to talk to me, and I just turned around and said, hold on a second. I pulled up a chair and I said, please, tell me your story. And the beauty of that story and that friendship that has started is that Jessie and her husband Mark have agreed to come here today to tell you the story of how she died and how she's here to talk to you. So please welcome to the stage Mark and Jessie. Hello. Welcome. Thank you for being here. So first of all, some pleasantries. This is Mark, this is Jesse. And what's your last name?
Crowley.
Look at that. Can you tell they're married? 3.5 years of marriage, and they're a fantastic couple and happily married. And let's just dive right into the story then. So what happened to you?
Okay, so I have some pretty severe allergies, and this was probably about 5 years ago at this point that this occurred. I was in college at the time. I was working as an EMT, which is a person that goes on an ambulance. I switched days with my partner on this particular weekend because I had a nursing class I needed to go to, and it was a special skills lab. In that skills lab, I must have contacted one of the things I was allergic to without really knowing it. And I didn't really realize I had come in contact to it because I had some pretty bad allergies that day anyways. So I kind of just ignored the signs of what was going on. Long story short, about an hour to 2 hours later, I ended up in the nurse's office at school because I was in a severe allergic reaction. I have something called anaphylaxis, which basically is where all my airways close and I can't get air into my body, so I suffocate. And the RN there called the doctor. When the doctor came in, he actually heard me struggling to breathe from outside of the clinic and called an ambulance. The ambulance came, and it was my partner and the guy that I had traded shifts with, and he comes down, sees me, and he just picks me up, throws me over his shoulder, and ran me out to the ambulance. From the point we were at college, to the nearest hospital, usually takes about a 15 to 20 minute drive. He got us there in 8 minutes, because he was driving very, very fast. My partner was in the back with me, and I've known him for a very long time, and he's an amazing EMT, and now paramedic. But at the time, he looks at me and he goes, Jess, you're not breathing. And I'm like, well, yeah, really. Couldn't really talk at that time. I'm like, this is news to me. So he gives me some oxygen, and then he starts panicking because he realizes I'm dying. And by the time we got to the ER, my partner was pretty much like sheet white. He was in shock, barely able to like articulate what was going on with me to the oncoming nurses because he was in so much shock. They actually ended up having to treat him. it was pretty funny.
It's helpful.
So then they took me back into a room, and at this point, they, from later on when I've talked to people, that because I knew everyone in the ER, they said that I wasn't responsive, which means that when they talked to me, I couldn't answer them. I remember answering them. I thought I was talking back to them, but apparently it was in my head. I wasn't actually physically capable at that point. And I had just learned my nursing protocols of how you would run a code for CPR on a person. So I'm in there, and they're trying to find a vein to give me the medication called epinephrine that would help me be able to breathe again. And at this point, my cardiovascular system had started to shut down. So they kept poking me, trying to find a vein, and they couldn't find one. And they tried all the way from my up in my wrist, all the way up to my arm, and up at the top of my arm, they found my brachial artery and gave me an IV there. When they did that, I saw the nurse pull up the medication and start to put it in there, and the doctor reached over and just slammed it in. That moment, I sat up and I could breathe again, but my heart rate started going up really, really high. It started out, normally my heart rate's around 65, 67 on a good day. It started going up higher and higher, and I'm looking at the monitor and my heart rate's about 120, and I was like, well, that's a little fast, but I'm on epinephrine, so that's pretty normal. Then I go look at it again a few minutes later, it's at around 240, which is not okay, and that's about the point where the doctor goes,
understatement.
We're gonna have to cardiovert you, which means he's gonna have to give me an electrical shock to reset my heart's rhythm, because I was in a dangerous rhythm, or a rhythm that would not sustain my life, because when your heart's beating that fast, it doesn't circulate the blood properly. So they bring in the crash cart, which is the cart that has all the medications for CPR. And I remember having an intense pain when they shocked me, and then I don't remember after that. I was told that they did CPR on me for about 20 minutes, and they decided that I wasn't gonna make it, and they called me, which means they gave me a time of death. They then, because I was so young, they have to call the county coroner to investigate what happened. So they have to leave the room exactly how it is. So they put a sheet over my head, closed the door, and left. About an hour-ish to 2 hours later, I'm not really sure of the time frame because I was dead during this time. Like, I don't know how long it was.
You generally have a hard time recalling time when you're dead.
Yeah, exactly. They told me it was about an hour to 2 hours, and that fits around the same time frame because I woke up coughing with a sheet over my face, so I'm, like, fighting the sheet, trying to get it off my face. I'm choking on what's called an ET tube, so they put a tube in my throat to help try and get my airway open again. So I extubate myself. I took it out myself. I had my IV open and I closed that, and I'm struggling to try and like get up and figure out what's going on, and the coroner came in. And the coroner, I happen to know he was my friend because I worked on the ambulance.
So imagine.
He thinks I'm playing a practical joke on him because he and I played a lot of practical jokes on each other, and he thought I was getting him back. And he was like, okay, Jess, this isn't funny. Like, you call me all the way up here to tell, like, and pretend that you're dead and then you're not. He's like, that's not that funny. And I was like, what are you talking about? I'm like, I'm not dead. I was like, I just had an allergic reaction. He's like, okay, well, let's go down to the nurse's station and see, you know, what's going on. So I gather up my gown and we walk down to the nurse's station. As we're walking down to the nurse's station, the nurse looks at me, screams, and passes out. She faints. She thinks she's seeing a ghost.
Or a zombie.
Or a zombie. Yeah. I like to tell people that. I'm a zombie.
Yeah.
The undead. So then the doctor comes around the corner, and he sees me, and I know this doctor pretty well. He grabs me by the shoulders, and he's like, Jess, why did you die on me? Don't ever do that again. I'll kill you.
I'll kill you.
I went, okay. And, after that, I ended up having to have a friend come pick me up and drive me home because everybody had left. They all thought, all my friends that were there for me, they all left because they were told that I was dead. They had dispatched a police car to go tell my parents that I had died. Thankfully, they called them back before it got there. Because I was about 8 hours away from my parents.
Wow.
So, yeah, that's my story.
Can you say thank you for sharing your story? Like, I have a okay, we're going to have about 2 minutes available for questions towards the end here. So if you've got a question, we'll run a mic to you. But I have a couple that I think everybody will want to know. And first of all, this is really cool. Why do you think that God saved her?
For me.
Absolutely.
Isn't that a great answer, yeah. Right? So, ladies, this is the kind of guy you want to, right?
Exactly.
And they met shortly hereafter, and when talking with you, you basically said that you feel like God saved you because you had work to do, and you're both thinking about being missionaries, and and the good news is you don't fear death anymore because you've done it,
yeah.
Right? So, you know, kind of like you go skydiving the first time, the second time's easier, right? So you've died once, and so being a missionary will be a little bit easier for you. The thing that everybody, I think, wants to know is, so what did you see when you were, what did you feel?
Nothing. I really had nothing that I saw, nothing. I mean, it was literally like I woke up, I was asleep and then woke up. I didn't have anything that happened.
Before you were passing away, had you made peace? Had you kind of said, like when you woke up, were you like, oh, thank God I'm back? Or were you like, okay, God,
oh, no,
I'm
I
ready
was
to
mad.
Go. Okay, explain that.
Right before they shocked me, I realized I was dying. And I was actually very happy because I was excited that I was going to get to go to heaven. I remember having that feeling. And then when I realized that I didn't die, I got very angry with God. I was like, why did you not let me die? Because at the time, I had just broken up with my boyfriend. And then I ended up, because I had a lot of complications from the event where I had several infections and things like that, it took me about 3 months of different medications and different trips back and forth to the hospital and having a bunch of allergic reactions. And I ended up having to drop out of school. So I was like, God, why did you save me for this? Like, you saved me to ruin my life. So I was extremely angry. And there was a point where I was covered in hives from head to toe from a new medication they gave me that I ended up being allergic to. And I was just in tears. And I remember screaming at, well, I couldn't scream that well. My tonsils were exploded. But I was screaming in my brain to God. I'm like, why did you save me for this? I was like, you said you would never give me anything more than I can handle, and I can't handle this. The moment I said that, my hives disappeared. I still ended up having to have surgery to remove my tonsils, but I no longer had any allergic reactions, and all of the medications, I was able to stable out on them.
Hmm. That's a great story. Well, do you guys, we have maybe 2 minutes, just a couple of questions. Michael, where are you? He's going to run this microphone. If you want to ask someone who's been dead of something, this might be your only chance. Yeah.
Hello. I'm out of shape, guys. I can't.
I didn't think this was actually going to happen.
Hi.
Oh. Hi.
Hi, Andrew.
No, I'm not going to stand.
Stand up.
Okay, I'm standing.
Thanks. And get to it quick.
Sorry?
Quick.
Oh, in the time that you were pronounced dead, do you like remember what happened, or if you went to heaven, what was it like? Something. Oh no, you said no.
No, I really have no.
Somebody was taking a nap.
No memory.
Thank you.
Hi. Now, when you went to heaven, were you disappointed? I mean, so when you died, were you disappointed when you did not see heaven?
Oh, that's interesting.
No, that never actually. Was something that I considered. I was just angry I was still alive.
Thank you.
Pass that mic.
Maybe one more question if someone's got one.
Oh, okay.
Oh, we got one right here, I think. Was your hand up?
I'm already on my way.
Go ahead, Mike. Right. Just get there, man. Let's go. Perfect.
Now, Mark, you said yourself, and I don't know if it was joking or whatever, but you said that God brought her back to life for you. And I want to ask her opinion on this. Why do you think God brought you back to life?
That's a great question.
So, this was...
It's an excellent question.
Micah.
So this was something that I kind of struggled with because I didn't really see a reason as to why that God brought me back. But ultimately, it comes down to the fact that God is sovereign, and he can do anything he wants to do. And I believe that I felt very strongly that God was like, I'm just not done with you. There's more that you need to do here.
When I first heard this, there are a couple. I've read all the books about people going to heaven and coming back, and now there's movies. The thing that it really shocked me, I went home that Easter, and I just kept looking at my wife and be like, I really think she died, and I really think there's no scientific explanation. I really think she's back. Like, that's, and this wasn't about I had a miraculous trip to heaven, you know, the kind of the skeptical, like the heaven tourism business, right? This was not that. This was somebody who died isn't claiming anything supernatural about what happened when she was gone. It was just simply, medically she died, and scientifically she died. And there's no scientific explanation for how she can be back. One of the books that I read kind of researching for this was actually a neurosurgeon who died, and he was an atheist when he died. And he did have a spiritual experience. And when he came back, he went in and he analyzed kind of the five main reasons that people think scientifically you can die and lose all the oxygen from your body and the rest and come back. And they're all bogus in his opinion. And I think he's right. We don't know what happened. And if you are a skeptical scientific person who says, I demand proof, this is pretty good. And if this doesn't do it, and I know for most of you who are skeptical scientific thinkers, this doesn't do it. You now have evidence about creation. You have evidence about from the Bible of all of those miracles happening. And Jesus actually said, when he was asked about this, if you don't believe, and this was a story about someone coming back from the dead too, or wanting to, if you don't believe in the prophets and in me and in what the scriptures say, there is no proof that will do it for you. So my question to you is, you know, you don't have to sign a statement of faith to be here at Oaks. And I just want to kind of meet you on that ground. You've now heard some evidence. What do you do with it? And if you stay skeptical, now you've got something else to balance things out. And you will never fully reason yourself to God. If you could fully reason yourself to God, your brain would be the same size as his, and then he wouldn't be much of a God at all, right? But reason is our friend in finding God. And now you've got some evidence to weigh with this. And the last thing that I want to say, and then you'll be on your way to advisories, is simply this. So what if you came in this morning and you said, I don't think miracles happen, and now you think they did, and God really saved Jesse, but he didn't save someone that you love? Well, what if God had saved, first of all, I'm sorry, and I don't have a good enough explanation for that yet. And that's the case for me too. I've lost people who I'm close to who I prayed for. Nathan is the exception to the rule. So the first thing is I'm deeply sorry that you've gone through something like that. Now, when we think through that, then we say, well, what if God had saved that person? Okay, so God saves that person. Then you might have a neighbor down the street who gets sick, and you pray for them, and God saves that person. Okay, so now God has saved everyone that you know. Are you then going to be happy when you hear about what's happening in Africa with famine and with Ebola and the next AIDS crisis and whatever else happens? Are you then going to go, well, God did enough miracles here so he can... No, you're going to say, well, God, please do a miracle over there, right? Otherwise, you're just heartless. And then at that point, if God doesn't intervene, you'll say, well, you intervened here and here and here and here, and now you don't care about them enough. Now I'm not going to believe, right? So what we're all really after, what we all really want, I'm sorry, I'm standing in front of you guys, but what we're all really after, what we all really want is not the next miracle. We want heaven on earth. We want the kingdom of God to reign. We want an end to gossip and slander and murder and assault and broken sexuality and broken relationships and all of the rest of it. And we want God's kingdom to come to earth. And the good news I want to end today with you is just simply to say this: that's happening. The gospel that Jesus proclaimed is the kingdom of God is at hand. It is here. It has come near you. And for any who are his disciples, you are learning how to be alive in his kingdom today, and you are spreading his kingdom. And the good news for those of you who aren't his disciples yet is there is no high bar to get into his kingdom. All he's looking for is a humble, repentant person. And there's no other bar that he sets. A humble, repentant person who says, Jesus, I would love for your kingdom to reign on earth. and you're all invited into that. After chapel, there'll be a few students. Helena, Evan, Travis will be down here, and they're here to pray with you if you'd like to pray with them. If you are, I'm just going to pray for us in a minute. If you are kind of sensing that God's up to something with you, if this has kind of swayed you, then don't let that go. It might be God. It might be this morning's breakfast. You don't know, but it might be the Holy Spirit too, right? And come and pray with someone if you'd like to. And otherwise, after I pray, you are dismissed. And I just want to say thank you for your attention this morning and for honoring our two guests. Could you please give them a round of applause? Yeah. Thank you, guys. Just stay there, but thank you. And if you wouldn't mind, just take your hands and extend them in front of you. This is a way that we just say that we're going to receive what God is giving. And if you don't want to do that, that's okay too. Well, Lord, we're all searching for something, no matter what our background is. And I believe we're all searching for you. And I pray that today we might be found. And for those of us who have known you our whole lives, we need to be found again today and again tomorrow. And for those who haven't found you yet, maybe it's today. And Holy Spirit, I pray for a powerful blessing to come into each of these students' lives, God, that they would just sense that your peace and your justice and your goodness are real, and that they stop asking for the next miracle, but instead become agents of your kingdom, bringing your kingdom to earth. We ask this in the powerful name of Jesus. And all God's people said, amen. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you. May he be gracious unto you and give you his peace. Amen. Enjoy advisory.